All right. Whose birthday is today? You have a January birthday? Cammy has a January birthday. Who else has a January birthday? Okay, so Cammy, Kirsten, and Lisa Moore have January birthdays. But since Lisa and Kirsten aren't here, they're just not going to get happy birthday sang to them right now. So we get a solo for Cammy McGee. All right, who's going to sing? Somebody give me a happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Cammy. Happy birthday to you. And many more.
Jane, come on. Do you have an announcement? Who has Janet. Janet. Janet, come here, Janet. Janet got demoted.
Good evening, beloved. Did that sound like a minute? Beloved. All of you are. Okay. Glad to see everyone gathered back here. And it seems like it's been a long Christmas. Mine just ended last Sunday night. But anyway, that's the only announcement I have about me. The rest of them, tonight, Brandon Richardson was supposed to be here tonight, most of you know. And he is not... I will say he's just a little under the weather. We're going to pray for him. We're going to keep praying for him because he's going to be leading a conference for the next 3 days. And he should be with us next Wednesday. Is that right? All right. Then we also have another encounter weekend coming up. Not this weekend, but the next with John Paul Sprecher. Watch your Facebook announcements for times. But assuming they'll be the same times as usually. Friday night, Saturday afternoon, and then Saturday evening and Sunday morning. You don't want to miss him. It's going to be awesome. For you ladies, most of you are on Facebook and have checked our Sassy page, but just a reminder to make a note on your calendar that the last weekend in March, we will be having a retreat. Yay! for our Sassy ladies, and it's going to be great. It's going to be at... the Gibson's Lake House. I started to say clubhouse. I think it's probably more than it. we can be a club. Okay. So anyway, that's it, I think, for right now. One more.
If there are any ladies who wanted to participate in the prayer partner and you haven't drawn a name, make sure that you catch up with me before you leave. To draw names?
Okay, and then one more announcement. The last January 30th, it's the last Friday of the month. Hannah and I are going to open up our house and do another worship night. We're going to do 5-6 hours into the night, and so we'll give more updates. But I just figured we'd go ahead and throw that out there now, and then we'll put some stuff on Facebook and stuff going forward. So.
All right, Shabbat. I'm going to read this for you guys. There's a meaning to that. You have to pray and get it. Okay, I want to read this to you guys before we start. This is a guy wrote this prophetic word. I don't go to Elijah List, and I don't go searching and seeing what people are prophetically saying. I just don't like that. It's just my preference. But this was sent to me this morning, and I just, man, it was right on. And I think just from knowing where we're at, like as far as certain people in the room tonight, I know that this was a real word for me. But I know it was a real word for you guys. I shared it with some of you, and I want all of us to to hear this word, because it's relevant to what's happening in your life. You know, the kingdom of God is it's everything, but it has a cost to it. You know, it's not something, it's precious. But you know, the man that found the field, and it says he found the treasure in the field. He says he went and sold everything he had, not to buy the treasure, but he bought the field. And so the kingdom is the treasure, and you can't buy the treasure because you can't afford it, right? But you can actually buy the field. And you know, it's giving up the things you have, and that doesn't mean materially speaking, but it means that to much given, much shall be required. And great promises come with great trials and great testing. And one of my favorite Psalms passages says, until his word came to pass, and that his is a lowercase s, which means you and I, because it's we're not God, but it says, until his word came to pass, David penned this, the word of the Lord tested him. And so we all have a word over our life. You guys have a word over your life you're contending for the future, not just for this year, for 2015. And we have a word over this community that we're contending for. And until that word comes to pass, the word of the Lord's going to test us and try us and see if we're faithful to carry it. Does that make sense to you guys? So if you have problems in your life right now, if things don't look like they're adding up, guess what? You're in the kingdom, and you come into the kingdom through much tribulation. Okay? So this is what will encourage you. This is the year of promise. This is what James Maloney says. Thank you. Oh, that's great. Ooh. It's like Mufasa. Ooh. The Lion King. Ooh. Possessing our land. It says, as your days are, so shall your strength be. Deuteronomy 33:25. What this is telling us is that life, the circumstances of our day-to-day living, will not leave us like an empty reservoir, some dry well. No, as the demands of each day are, so shall our inner resources of strength be to make us equal to any situation we face. We can wake up each morning knowing with assurance that our strength is more sufficient for the demands of that day. This is our land of inheritance, and this is your year of promise. We're living in the realm of full supply. You just have to know that this is true and trust in the Lord's unwavering faithfulness toward completing the work he has begun in you. This truth is all-encompassing. For any needs we have, our strength will be sufficient to face physical struggles, financial strain, spiritual fatigue, mental and emotional distress. The Lord makes sure we are up to the challenge. We don't have to function in raw nerves. You know what I mean? Anybody know what I mean? But what about my circumstances, you may be asking? It might seem you've been waiting for the manifestation of truth and strength in your life for years. I don't demean anything someone may be going through. God knows these past couple years have been the most difficult of my adult life, hands down. If anything, it's made me more sympathetic to the difficulties others face. But if it doesn't change what the Word of God says, for all the promises of God in Him are yes and in Him, amen, to the glory of God through us, Corinthians 1:20. While we are waiting to receive the answers, and they are coming, the Lord is teaching us valuable lessons in trust and reliance upon Him to encourage our faith, not to make us miserable. Wow. Anybody feel that? It's truth. It's a true word. There's a difference. I've said this. There's a difference in what's true and the truth. What's true is where you're at. It's being honest, being vulnerable. Hey, this is just where I'm at. But the truth is where you're going, and it's the promise that's going to get you there, you know? And so we've got some plowing to do. We've got some things the Lord's going to do through us and in us and around us. And happy birthday. Yay, God, for you. Dodge. I like Dodge. Used to have a Dodge truck. It was red. It was really nice. Totally switching gears here. But God's faithful. He's faithful. He's faithful over us. He's faithful. He's called us. And listen, we will not contend for anything less than a move of the Spirit. That's what we're going for. That's what we're going after. We set our eyes on it. A move of the Spirit of God is what God has promised. And that's what we're clinging on to. And so who here loves the Lord? Yeah, you wouldn't be here if you didn't. You wouldn't be here in my living room. You know, I wouldn't be letting you in if I didn't love the Lord. It's true. So let's stand. Let's pray. Father, we bless you, Lord. We love you. You know, let's do something real quick. Look to the person to your right and to your left. Just look at them. What does God think about that person? You don't have to say it, because some of you are thinking bad thoughts. Some of you are like, well, I'm giving you a smile, but I really feel terrible. I'm having a really bad season. Seriously, what does the Lord say about that person? You know, turn to the other side, look at the other person. What's the Lord say about that person? You know, can you get outside of where you are? And can you actually see them for what the Lord's saying and get outside of your circumstances and see things the way the Lord sees them? That's awesome, right? That's a real test of whether or not we're really in fellowship with God. Whether the waters are too high for us, whether the storm's too much. Anyways, I just felt we were supposed to do that. Lord, I love you. And Lord, we love you. We worship you tonight in spirit and truth. We bless you, Lord. You're so good to us. You're so faithful. You've given us your best. You've given us, God, you've given us amazing women, amazing men, Lord. You've given us amazing marriages. You've given us amazing young ones that they just want you, Lord. They found the road to Emmaus, and their hearts are burning. And Lord, we're just honored to walk together and to burn together and to burn for the one thing. We desire you. We want to know you, God. We want to be a community that's discipled by you and not by man, and that loves you and that loves people, Lord, that loves the world, and that the world can relate to us by our love and doesn't feel like we're judging them. But God, that we would be influencers, and that the Spirit of God would just pour out of us. Lord, that you're increasing us in such ways right now. Some of us don't see it, Lord, but you are. And the promises over our life are yes and amen tonight. And God, I just agree for every brother and sister in this room tonight that your plans for them are amazing. And God, they are going to do great exploits for your kingdom. And Lord, they're here, Lord, to be just transformation, Lord, makers, Lord, to transform nations. And Lord, you don't say any less about them. And that's what we say. That's our report. We love you. We bless you. And we just want to pour our worship out on you tonight, Lord. Yeah? Yeah? Oh, come on. That was weak. We want to pour our worship out on you, Lord. We want to worship you, God. We want to bless you, Lord. We want to just command our soul tonight just to bless the Lord. We want to see you pour out love in this room tonight. We want to see, God, the broken, God, just fixed. We want to see the fearful transparent. We want to see, God, just everything come into alignment tonight in our lives and our marriages. We bless you, Jesus. Amen. Lord, we want your Spirit to break out, God. And Lord, we just say yes. We say yes to your Spirit breaking out, Lord, in our life, whatever that looks like. And for some of us, it looks like moving our cars. So, sorry to be a buzzkill, but if your car is over here, like, you know, you guys know, like, the car, if you're parked on this side by my driveway, like, you got to go move your car. Does everybody know who that is? There's two cars over there that, like, I don't want you to get towed. Yeah, sorry. Just make sure that, listen, when you're coming in, it's a neighbor just called and she's freaking out, but if you just move it somewhere that where you're not in front of a fire hydrant and you're not past this my driveway over here, because it's just not safe. It's too close because of the lanes and whatnot. So who's the other car? Everybody know who that is? Okay. Thanks, buddy. Shift. This is what the spirit breaking out in our community. This is what it looks like, you know. Moving your cars. So, anyways, we're going to go back to where we were. I finished that song, so sorry.
I feel like we're entering a time of warfare worship. So if the Lord's just impressed that on your heart to release the songs of heaven over your heart, over this region, over this house, I just want you to get a little militant for a second and just declare those things and speak those things and speak against the work of the enemy and the plan of the enemy to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And just declare truth, just declare those things over this region. Father, we just speak that tonight, God. We say, Spirit, have your way. Lord, we set you up as king over this house, Lord, and over this region. And we say that you are king. You are Lord, Father. You have all authority to do what it is that you want to do, Father. Lord, we set you up to rule and to reign, Father, and we pave the way for you, God. Like John the Baptist, a voice in the wilderness, God, we just declare the things of you, God, over this community, God, with the things that you're stirring up, the things that you're doing, God. Lord, let those things come to pass. Let those things come into full fruition, Father. Lord, that if it means people get uncomfortable, if it means that things get stirred up, that people get dissatisfied and just uncomfortable, Father, we just declare that, Lord. We say a holy discontentment over this region, Father. A holy discontentment, God. A dissatisfaction with the way that things are, God, that stirs hearts to revival, that stirs this region to revival. Lord, we speak for what you are doing, God, and we just align our thoughts and our hearts with the plans of heaven. Lord, and we agree, God, we come into agreement with you, God, for this place. And we say, have your way in Rockwall. Have your way in Dallas. Have your way in Mesquite. Have your way in Garland. Have your way in Plano, Father. But start with us, God. Start with our hearts, Lord, here in this place tonight, God. Lord, that you would deal with anything in us, Father, that doesn't line up with what you have, God, that doesn't line up with your truth and with your word, Father, that tonight we would deal with those things here, God. And we would come into agreement with the things of heaven. Or that our heartbeat would match your heartbeat. No longer operating in selfishness, Father. Lord, we lay it all down to see what it is that you're doing. That it may not look like what we think it looks like. Lord, it's not about me. It's not about me. It's about you. It's all about you. And we're here to make your name famous in the earth. To make this your dwelling place. A place where your spirit can abide. Let's just sing that again. Spirit, break out. Break our walls down. Spirit, break out. Heaven, come down. Sing, Spirit. Spirit, break out. Break our walls down. Spirit, break out. Heaven, come down. Sound of heaven touching earth. Sound of heaven touching earth. Sound of heaven touching earth. Son of heaven said to her, this is the sound of heaven said to her, this is the sound of heaven touching earth. The sound of heaven touching earth. This is 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 the sound of heaven touching earth.
Father, we want heaven to invade our lives. That when we walked, when our feet walked the earth, we would hear heaven. That we would hear heaven in the workplace as we walk every day into the workplace or in the home, Father, or with our children or in our school. Father, in the education, like as we walk, we want to hear heaven. The sound of heaven, heaven's footsteps walking through our lives. Walking around us, in us, and through us. That heaven's reality would become our reality. That we would no longer think the way the world thinks, that we wouldn't see through worldly eyes, but we would see what heaven sees all around us. That we'd realize that your realm, your reality is greater than the reality right in front of us. No matter what situation we're walking through, no matter what season of life, Father, you've called us to walk. Whether it's a high hill or a low valley, that is where you want us. You've called us and you're with us in those places, God. That you're right there with us, that we feel your presence, that we know your voice. That heaven would invade every area. That we'd be a people that would live from heaven to earth. That we realize where we're seated in heavenly places. That it wouldn't be a lofty thought or a nice, warm, fuzzy to us, but it is the truth. And that heaven's truth would become the bedrock of our lives. That we would plant it into our hearts, that we would solidify it. You are the truth, you're the way, and you're the life. That you've called us to live abundantly and to live life abundantly. We thank you and we pray this in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen. Okay, well, she's talked about the dirge, right? The dirge and the dance. We sang, you didn't sing. We danced, you didn't dance. We threw a party, you didn't come to our party. You know, I sent you a Facebook friend request and you denied it. You didn't accept my Twitter. I invited you to my baby shower. You didn't show up. I put you on my target list for this, and you got me something I didn't want. I'm just trying to make this practical for some of you, because is it working? It's reality, right? Some of y'all are really practical people, and dark sayings sometimes can be hard to understand. Do we have something I can put on this right here? Can I use that? So, perfect. Thanks, man. Did y'all see my shoes? I'm getting less religious right now. That's why I wore these. Some of y'all think I'm not being serious. I am. So, this is something I'm just going to roll it out to you guys tonight. Something I've really been praying about. It's something I've really been chewing on for 2015. And I think it's going to be very applicable to you and where you're at. And it'll always be relevant. It's not something that, you know, church is not something, following Jesus is not something where it's, we really teach you how to be holy. It's really not. It's not where we find out all your issues and we sit around and we talk about this is your issue, that's your issue. It's really about getting you involved, getting you activated. And what does a community look like that actually knows the word of the Lord for you and can tell you the season that you're in and say, hey, here's the word of the Lord. Here's what you need to do. See you later. Right? Not see you later in the sense of I don't care about you, but hey, I'm giving you the word of the Lord. This is, you need, you know, the Spirit of the Lord is going to bear witness and he's going to help you get to where you need to be versus real clingy and just going to walk you through this and going to, you know, somewhere there's both, right? We need both of those things. But I just want to know what the word of the Lord is and, you know, I can let the rest take care of itself. Okay. Does that make sense? Okay. I mean, I think that's ultimately what community looks like is, you've got a problem. We've got a solution. Here's the solution. Now, we love you. Hold you accountable to actually working out the answer and quit dwelling on the problem. So I think we spend a lot too much time trying to hash out what's already been done and not enough time trying to get into our destiny and getting our calling and actually being who we're called to be. And, you know, we're just kind of going the wrong direction on a one-way highway. So if that makes any sense. Luke chapter 3. It says Luke 3, let's go start in verse 2. It says, while Annas and Caiaphas were high priests, the word of God came to John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness. Anybody feel like they're in the wilderness? No? Everybody's on the mountain. No one's in the wilderness right now. Don't be shy. How many people do we have in the wilderness? Come on, raise your hand. Raise your hand. Okay, good. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord for the wilderness. It's good. And, the light. Can you turn that light on, please? Babe? Thank you. Much better. And there was light. And he went around into the region around the Jordan preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled and every mountain and hill brought low. The crooked places shall be made straight and the rough way smooth. And all flesh shall see the salvation of God. It's a great, great way to end. All flesh will see the salvation of God. Okay. What is your life unto? What's the purpose of your life? Why are you here? Why are you in my living room? Why are we breathing right now? Why were you born? You know, those are the questions that we want to find. We want answers to. We want resolve. Anyone want some resolve in their life, some resolution? This is the answer. This is what you're trying to get to. This is, if God is the author, which he is, the finisher for you is that God would see, people would begin to see salvation in your life. And that's the flesh. That's the all the flesh would begin to see the salvation of God. Just, man, Jesus lives inside that person. Why does Jesus live inside that person? Well, look at the joy of the Lord. Look, they're going through. You see these tribulations. You see so-and-so hasn't gotten paid in over 3 months and they don't have any money. And man, but you see the joy in their life. Or so-and-so just, you know, lost somebody. But yet, you know, man, do you see the faith they're holding on to? Or do you see the fruit of the Spirit that that person's operating in? Do you see the power of God and the anointing? Do you see the truth and just the unwavering persistence of that person? Right? That's all part of having a relationship with Christ, that Christ living in you, people can see it, right? It's all flesh is actually looking. Listen, we are living epistles read by all men, right? We are, you know, you can read the epistles in the New Testament. Everybody know what I'm talking about? The epistles, the little small books. There's Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and then you've got, you know, you've got Romans, you've got 1 John, you've got John, you've got Peter, you've got James. Those are epistles written by individuals. Listen, every one of you is writing an epistle right now. Your life is a living epistle. What are you writing? And what are you writing is actually, what are people reading? If you don't write, people can't read. And so God writes his name on you. And it's your job as he writes his name to allow him to do those things. As he writes his name on you, people can actually see it. But here's my concern. We don't have his name written on us, and we walk around with a bunch of propaganda and labels, and then we use signs, right? Saying this is where God is. Well, no, we are the sign. We are to be the sign that makes people wonder. Okay, we should. That's your living epistle. This is who we're supposed to be. This is the fundamentals. This is the foundation. So everything going on in your life right now is just a process of getting you through the gate of the reality of that's your reality. And this is who you are, and you're letting go of things that are of this world, and you're actually coming into an unshakable kingdom. That's where we're at. That's what God's doing in your life. And John actually was the forerunner for this. John was a voice of one crying in the wilderness. A voice. You know what the Greek word for voice is? Anybody got a phone in here? Pull that thing out. Put it to your ear. Put it to your ear. That's the voice. It's the voice. It's a phone. That's what the Greek is phone, right? So I've got my phone here. I got my connection to God. I'm talking to God. This is the voice. He's talking to me in the wilderness, right? And no one knows he's talking to me. Right? No one wants to have anything to do with me because no one wants to go to the desolation, the desert. No one wants to go to the wilderness, right? But see, the wilderness is where God calls us, where we can hear his voice, where we can kind of get the 1-800 talk to God number, right? It's where you get your calling card. And John said yes to going there. And we read this passage and sometimes it just depresses me. Oh, the voice of one crying, God, I'm so sad, I'm depressed, get me out of the wilderness, right? That's what we think that means. That's not what it means. It's actually, it's the voice of God, and it's the voice of John hearing God, and John is crying. You know why he's crying? Because that crying, the word is utterance. He's actually the utterance of the Lord, the Spirit and the unction of the Lord is coming on him, and he's crying. He's moaning, he's travailing for the purposes of God in a place that no one wants to go to because there's this chasm between the world and the kingdom, right? The world, everyone wants to be in the world, but no one wants to go into the wilderness to actually come into the kingdom. But there's a man, there's a forerunner by the name of John that actually says yes to the purposes of God that says, you know what, Crystal, I'm calling you into the wilderness. I'm calling you to come and worship me, just like Egypt. Go and tell them to let my people, go tell Pharaoh, let my people go. Why? So they can come worship me in the wilderness, right? So I'm calling Crystal to come worship me in the wilderness so that Crystal can hear my voice, so she can be one agreeing with the utterance of the Lord, crying out for an intercession and travail. What are we crying out for? We're crying out, prepare the way of the Lord. right? Prepare the way of the Lord. Like, we want to build a highway from the world to the wilderness, because the wilderness is where people are going to find God. It's where they're going to hear God. It's where the realities of we let go of the things that so grip us. It's where you lay those things that so easily ensnare you. You lay them to the ground and you realize, wait a minute, that thing was a snake and I picked it up. Like you remember Moses, he's got the staff, and God asks him this question. What is that, Moses? He says, a staff. Whose staff is it? It's my staff. Throw it down. He throws it down. What happens? It turns into a snake. He realized the whole time he was holding a snake. It's perception, right? It's the understanding that things become different. Reality becomes different in the wilderness. And that's why God will often take us there, because he'll take us there to wash our car. Your car gets dirty. Your car's your ministry. You get dirty. You get dirty. God's going to take you to the wilderness. He's going to show you how to be clean. He's going to show you how to walk in purity. And he's going to say, hey, this is holy ground. Take your shoes off, right? This is holy ground. It's where the angel of the Lord comes and he camps around those who fear him, because they know him. We're going to know him. We're going to fear him. We're going to find him in the wilderness. So listen, step one, there is a step one. Thank God for the wilderness. Because it's the first step of where the Lord's called. It's an invitation that you said yes to, right? The Lord called you there. So are you thankful for that? Some of us, all of us should be, Lord, call us to the wilderness, right? How many of you would say, God, call me to the wilderness. Oh, I just want to come find you. I want to hear your voice. God, I don't want T-Mobile anymore. I don't want AT&T. I don't want Verizon. God, I want the God network, you know? So prepare the way of the Lord. Make his path straight. How many of you would say if we were to go from right here, does everyone know where Wiley is? Yeah? What's the fastest way to get to Wiley? Just get on this road right here, man. It's a straight shot. Just a straight shot, right? And the kingdom... straight looks crooked, right? In the natural right now, that looks straight. That looks like that's how you get to Wiley. God doesn't work that way. God puts you on a roller coaster. He takes you through highs, takes you through lows, takes you through turns. He puts you on, like, you know, that Texas Giant or the Titan, you know, at Six Flags. And you're like, Lord, I wouldn't have done it that way. I would have just taken a straight shot, even kill. The Lord likes the highs. He loves the lows, right? And so if your life doesn't have this and doesn't have that, then you're on the straight. You're on the road called straight. It's called the world. You're on the world's street called straight. You're not on the straight that Paul was put on, right? Paul was actually taken out of his crooked ways, and the Lord said, I'm even going to put you on a street called straight. And then I'm going to open your eyes. You're going to be able to see. You're going to awaken from your demonic, you know, legalism, right? Does that make sense? So what I'm trying to say is God prepares the way. You become the messenger to say, prepare the way of the Lord. And your message, God does this. He, like, if you're a drawing book, you know, he colors way outside the lines. And then you show people and say, this is a beautiful picture. And they say, that is really stupid. That looks really ugly. But that's the God we serve. God doesn't color in between the lines. He's not a God that can be put in a box, right? He just doesn't do that. But in his eyes, it's beautiful. But it's all perception. How do you see the picture, right? And so I, if you look at my life, I know personally, my life does not look straight. It looks crooked, right? The world says my life looks crooked, but God says my life looks straight. So if the world understands your walk, guess what? You're on a crooked walk for the kingdom. You're on a straight walk for the world. It's all perception. Does that make sense? It says this. It says, every valley shall be filled. The word valley in there, does anybody ever wonder what this means? Every valley shall be filled. What's he talking about? Is he literally talking about a valley? What's he talking about? Right? This is the great prophet that's the greatest prophet that was ever born of a woman until the kingdom of God came. He's obviously, he means something. He's valley. If you look that word up, it means a chasm. It's a profound difference between things. It's a ravine. It's a differing of opinions. So if you have opinion about something that doesn't line up with God's fact, you have a valley. So what needs to happen? God needs to come in and God needs to fill it. He needs to fill up your opinions with his facts and his truths, right? So God, the man of God is dealing with your perceptions, your thoughts, your understandings. He's dealing with your mind. He's dealing with your heart, right? Because the Lord's dealing with his heart in the wilderness. Therefore, now he's becoming the messenger to deal with man's hearts. Ultimately, I think that's what prophets are supposed to do. They're not supposed to give you your telephone number. They're not supposed to give you some moving word that says, wow, you know that about me. I think that's part of it. But they're supposed to deal with your hearts, and they're supposed to challenge you, challenge your mind. They're supposed to challenge where you're at and help you get to where you're going through the word of the Lord, whether that's the scripture, whether that's the vocal, whether that's whatever through revelation. That's the purpose of the prophetic. And John's dealing with this. He's saying, hey, fill up your opinions, fill up your ideologies, fill up your mindsets, and be ye conformed to the mind of Christ. Yep. And he says this, every mountain and hill brought low. Well, that's pretty easy. He's talking about every high place shall come down. Remember that song? Every high place will come down. Altars, right? Every high place will come down. I don't know the rest of the song, but you got a high place. You got an idol in your life. You got pride in your life. You've got something that's false in your life. It's coming down, right? God's going to bring it down in the wilderness. He's going to humble those. He says he exalts those that are humble, but those that are proud, he humbles them. I don't want to be humbled by God. I humble myself, hopefully. And the crooked places shall be made straight. The crooked places, he's talking about warped, perverted. I say perverted. What do you think? Come on, somebody say something. I say perverted. What do you think? You think some old man's looking at you, little girls, or something? I mean, well, yes. A pervert, right? I know. I knew a lot about perverts growing up because the world knows about perverts. Perversion is a form of the wrong version, right? It's twisted. It's winding. It's religion is perversion. Okay, why is it perversion? Because it perverts the word of God. It makes it of no effect because it follows the rituals of man. Okay, and so God gives us his version, and so he makes the crooked straight. But like I said, the crooked in your natural mind, what you think is crooked and what he's talking about is totally two different things. And he says that he makes the rough way smooth. Rough ways, he's talking about your jaggedness. We got some jagged swords in here. Pull out your sword right now. What's it look like? You know, is your sword jagged? Does it need to be beat on a little bit? Does it need some sharpening? That's why relationships are so essential. The relationships in this and what God's doing today in this age is so essential because iron sharpens iron, and people that don't want to sharpen iron with other iron, their swords get jagged. People that don't want truth, their sword's going to get jagged. People that don't want to be accountable, your sword's jagged. You don't want to be responsible and steward what God's said and who God's put in your life. Your sword's jagged. And God wants to smooth out the roughness. He wants to smooth out those things. I mean, every man of God struggles with pride. Every woman of God struggles with pride. It's not something you can cast out. You can't cast out the flesh. It has to be crucified. You can't crucify a demon. It has to be cast out. Okay? But God wants to smoothen us. Like, we've got some really strong people in this room. Very strong. Very opinionated. Very opinionated people. Right? I'm probably one of them. Thank you. Okay? But you know what? Here's the deal. I submit myself to God. I submit myself to people in my life. If you want to rebuke me, rebuke me, and I will take delight in it. you know, I'll carry it to the Lord. And I'm okay with that. And he won't offend me. So, I'm not saying I'm unoffendable. I'm just saying that ultimately, so don't try and offend me, okay? Because those that woe to those who bring the offense, okay? Don't put a noose around your neck by trying to offend me. That's just the word of the Lord. I'm sorry. That's what it says. So this is, listen. Hey. Hey. Yeah, I was pretty perturbed about that. But I let it go. I forgave Scott, you know. What were you thinking? He had to get right with God, and, you know, we had to work out salvation in him, you know. He had to get saved again. It's all right. So, moving on. This is the path that the Lord's taking all of us on. You want to be a messenger of God, and everyone's called to be a messenger of God. This is not a higher calling. This is, you're called to be a messenger of God. You're called to be an ambassador. Ambassadors speak for a nation. We speak for a nation that's called heaven. We speak for a God who's called Jehovah. He's called Emmanuel. He's God with us. We speak for him. And when the things in your life, when you allow those things to actually speak to your heart and find out, listen, if I ask you right now, what is success for you? How do you determine success right now in your life? Think about that. What does that look like? Does it look like having a job that pays well? Does it look like security or does it look like pleasing God? And pleasing God means those things are nothing, right? I'm not there. It's a process. We're all in a process. It's a process of sacrifice of, listen, to follow God, he always requires things, right? How many of you really want to follow God? He requires it all, right? Now, don't get to thinking that, oh, he's going to require everything right now, because, no, that's religion. He's not requiring it all from you right now. He's requiring certain things from you right now, and all he's requiring is you say yes to it. And desire is birth. Discipline will carry you through, and ultimately we're going to delight, right? You can't stir up desire, but he can. Desire, discipline, delight in your marriage and every aspect of your life. Okay? The point here is not to draw you to a doctrine or a theology. The point is to raise you up, send you out, and for the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. For you to be an efficient and productive laborer for Christ, and for you to win souls by your actions, by your fruits, by your words, by your life, and not by a five-step of leading someone to the Lord, giving them to pray a prayer, and making them religious, right? It's not what this whole process of the Lord carrying us through this process is actually going to show us how to do life and how to be life and how to actually know him and how to make him known. Yes? Okay, so that's burning in me right now is to get that in every single one of us, and that we would understand what is the purpose, what's our purpose in life. It's so flesh, the people around you, your sphere of influence, will see the salvation of God working in your life. That's it. It's to equip you to be a minister of the gospel in whatever realm. If you're in the business place, then you know what? Bring the gospel to the business place. You know, you're God's man. If it's a nurse, if it's the gym, if you're, you know, whatever, it doesn't matter. You're called to do that. Yes. So what is success? So who wants to tell, what does success look? Well, I already talked to some of y'all about this, but somebody that hasn't answered this, you can stand up. And what does success look like for you right now? Not everybody at once. It's kind of a deep question. I understand that. Come on. That's good. Anybody else? Kirsten, what does success look like for you? Success for me in this season looks like you everyone in this room turning around and actually getting in their place and doing, you know, whatever God's called you to do. You know, that's success for me. So at least that's what I would hold as being success. My boss went to Africa. He said he came back. He's you know, multimillionaire. He said he found the difference between what's between being successful and being significant. Now he feels significant because he, you know. So, anyway, anybody? Yeah. So what's that test for you right now? Because that's your success right now, is your test right now. You don't have to share that if you don't want to. Yeah. See, we can say following God, and that's true, but what's the test? Because there's different ones in different seasons. We got to know what our test is right now. And until you pass that, you're just going to keep taking the same one. Right? So I love the answer. I'm just going to follow God. Well, yeah, it's true, but what's the test now? What's he trying to show you now? And are you being faithful? Or are you passing it? Because if not, it's just going to become habitual, cyclical. It will revisit you. And not only will it revisit you, it will revisit your family, your kids, and everything. All right, you got to break the pattern. You got to break the mold. Come here, talk. Go ahead. Keep going. Come here. Keep going. Keep going. Come on. Come on. Keep going. I just want him to stand here.
Yeah, I was taking it from the external into the internal. You know, these are our homes. This is the temple of the Holy Ghost. It's supposed to be. And have you ever just been reading the word, and then you get smacked? Somebody really smacks you. So I've been actually reading some different passages and going after stuff and really trying to find, what are you trying to say to me, God? You know, sometimes we get in that moment where we're really trying to hear him. He's really saying stuff, but we just don't understand what he's really saying. Anybody ever been there? And then you actually watch a video or somebody else is preaching, and the thing just really leaps off and really just nails you to the wall. And so this weekend we did the burn Saturday night and Sunday morning. Just had a great time. Really felt like a lot of family. Really felt like people just really became one. It was awesome. But one scripture really jumped out at me was Psalms 19:9, that the fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of God are right, righteous altogether. More to be desired than gold, yea, than fine gold, and sweeter than honey, even the honeycomb. So when you really break down those two verses, and you look at the fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The fear of the Lord is what's going to get us to becoming overcomers. That's what's going to get us to where we're not singing about the presence, but we actually invoke the presence to come with us. And you don't even have to say the presence of God. It's here, the presence falls in the room. A lot of times when there's not a presence, it's because of our condition of our soul. Either we're hard, either we've been in the world too long, we haven't really been creating a sanctuary for the Most High to show up in. It says the judgments, right after the fear, it goes into the judgments. The judgments of God are right. Righteous altogether. I don't know about y'all, but when I'm looking at the judgment of God, and if I'm in the wrong, I don't, you know what I'm saying? Ooh, they're right and righteous altogether. More to be desired than gold, yea, than fine gold. Sweeter than honey, yea, even the honeycomb. Well, I've tasted honey, and I like eating honeycomb. And I like having some gold. I mean, I like having a big fat paycheck. But if I'm in the way when judgment falls, that's not a good day for me. But what makes judgment good and sweet is when it's embraced in our life and we allow the God, the consuming fire of God, to purge us and get us from where we're at today to where he's trying to get us to, the final destination. So when you're looking at the thing that sets us apart and makes us different than the rest of the world, when you look at repentance, it says godly sorrow worketh repentance, right? But worldly sorrow, it just works grief. So you can get in worldly sorrow. Worldly sorrow is if my wife found out something I did, oh God, I'm in trouble. Now I got to start repenting. But when I go and lay down in bed at night and allow God to examine my heart, allow him to look me over throughout the day and see what is Todd McGee up to. I mean, have you ever ministered to somebody and you went back home? I used to get back in the shower after doing ministry and allow God to process all of my encounters with people and what we said and allow him to judge me. I mean, one time I gave a word out on Sunday morning, or actually on a Wednesday night to a guy, youth pastor, and had a right on, I mean, accurate prophetic word. When I got home, the Lord said, boy, you didn't give that in love. And I didn't, so it profited nothing. It was the right word, but it was given out of a wrong heart. So Sunday morning, I called him up publicly in front of everybody and apologized to him because I want to make sure I'm clean. So Kristen said, Kirsten said that her deal was, as long as she knows she's pleased God and she's done exactly what he asked, no matter what people's opinions are about her, as long as she knows she's right with him. So when you look at the text, I was looking at Saul and all his, you know, God sets him up to be king. He's head and shoulder above everybody, which tells me he should stand out among the crowd. He shouldn't be following the crowd. He should stand out and actually bring them to another standard. And see, you don't have to be tall to bring somebody to a standard. It has to be a condition of the heart. So God tests his heart. He sets him up to see where his heart is. The test or the judgment is just to show us what's rooted in Christ and what's not. If you build your house upon the rock, it says when the storms come, your house will still stand. If you build it on sand, what does it say it does? It falls apart. So when you're in a test, which most of us are in a test right now, I mean, Tom's talking about the roller coaster ride. Is God's plan from A to B? And most of us in our natural mind says, you know, Tom, you're missing it. That's not God. Yeah, it's really God. Because when I moved to Texas, I was thinking if I was God, what I would do is I'd just sweep two good deals and sell Todd's two spec homes, give another $80,000 in his thing, let him go borrow some money from the bank, immediately start building a house, then get him a couple of spec houses. Meanwhile, he can kind of filtrate and do a little bit of the kingdom stuff and intertwine. It's a whole lot more he's doing today than what he is doing back home. Take in mind, we were doing 80, 90 hours a week consumed with life. And God says, you know what? You're on a roller coaster. I'm going to take you to the top. I'm going to round the bend. And when you get going around the bend, right before you go down the hill, I'm going to hang you out to dry. And I'm going to stick you out on the rail with your hands all raised, ready for the fun ride. And everything's going to halt. And then Bugs Bunny's going to show up with a little carrot and go, hey, what's up, Doc? Smacking away like he's having a good old time. And I'm thinking, you know, Roadrunner's right around the corner. Coyote's right around the corner. And I get Bugs Bunny. What's up, Doc? So what God does is he smacks rude awakening on us because what he wants to do is change our whole mindsets. And that's what Tom's going after in John. John came to grab a hold of our mindsets because they were missing God. You're missing your encounters. I mean, we got dead religion that feeds us every day. And it prevents us from pushing through and getting into the Holy of Holies and having encounters with the living God. The one that we're about to give account for everything we've done in our bodies. So I'm over here going, golly, you just totally stopped my whole world. I mean, I had two businesses back home, a wife and kids, and running around like a wild man. My phone going off. You know what? I changed my phone number. And it's so nice not to have the thing ring every minute. Just shut everything down and just be quiet and pursue the Lord and see if he would like to speak to us. So I've been dilly-dagging around, looking at different texts and different passages and looking at Saul. So Saul goes on a journey with God. He's in the middle of Samuel shows up and says, you know what? I'll come back and I'll offer the sacrifice and I'll tell you what God's going to say. So he's got all the people gathered. It's kind of like us gathered in the room tonight. Samuel the prophet leaves. The altar's sitting there. We can't go forward until the altar gets dealt with. Many of us are at the altar. You can't go forward till your altar gets dealt with. The sacrifice has to be made. See what I'm saying? So Samuel goes off and Saul's sitting there. And they're waiting and waiting 5 days, 6 days, and God doesn't show up. I could see us charismatic. Man, we'd be given a prophetic word. God's about to do this thing for you. You know, we judge so many things by the natural. Oh, I know you've done this and that and the other. Well, yeah, big deal. Jesus died on the cross. But yet we justify all these means and we justify our freedoms and our rights to live however we want to live because we're righteous. Meanwhile, we never checked with the living God to see if it's okay with him. We do so many things just because we want to do them out of our own selfish lifestyle. We're not living as sacrifices. Those things that are holy and acceptable to God is somebody that lays down his whole life and becomes a living sacrifice. So here he is. He's on the sixth day. People are getting nervous. They're looking at the king thinking, you don't have a clue what you're doing. The enemy's approaching and we need to get something started. Seventh day comes. Samuel doesn't even come in the morning. The people begin to scatter. The enemy's coming closer. And he says, I'll pull the thing off. I'm going to sacrifice. And he sacrifices it. And I bet you money it was right after he did the sacrifice. Samuel pops his head out. Said, you missed it. You couldn't wait on God. And therefore, your whole kingdom's rent from you. So he turns and Saul grabs his garment and pulls on him to the degree that it rips his garment. And Samuel turns around and says, your kingdom will be torn just like you tore my garment. He said, yeah, that's okay. Just honor me before the people one more time. I'm thinking, you just missed your whole destiny and all you're concerned about is the honor of people, the honor of men, your placement, how you look, how you smell. And God's saying, you know, you're not the guy. You know, if we're going to be leaders for a whole culture that's going to hell, we better start shaking ourselves. It says to examine yourselves to see whether you're really in the faith or not. Not whether you can sing with the singers, clap with the clappers. Are you really in the faith? Have you really allowed the mirror of God to look at you and say, golly, where do I really fit? I mean, Tom had four questions, and you ought to give those four questions. You ought to write them down tonight. And go back and pursue the Lord to get those answers. Because it literally allows you to do some evaluation. He gave it to leadership last night. So then God comes to him and says, you know what? I'm going to let him have another test. And we went after this a couple of weeks ago. Midianites that were, Amorites. Amorites was, God made a covenant with Moses and said, I'll totally knock them off the face of the earth because they came out and warred against you and didn't have the fear of God. So when we start getting in the fear of the Lord, then we understand that his judgments are righteous altogether, and they are right and they're true. Because guess what? When we're walking 100% in God, he gets to judge everything that's in the way of the kingdom of God. But if we're outside of the destiny of heaven and what God really wants, we're in trouble. I mean, I remember one time I went to Bobby Connor and said, I think I'm supposed to fire my brother and get away from him. He said, yeah, I was wondering when you were going to do that. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, you've been under judgment. Your business has been under judgment because you put up with him. And he's under judgment, so now your business is under judgment because you got a relationship with him. Now, I guarantee you, if we looked at that a little bit, we'd start looking at our relationships a little bit different, wouldn't we? Ooh, they could be under judgments of God. Now, if God gives you grace to go and work with them, grace to go and love them, that's a different story. But it's hearing the voice of God. Did he tell you you could do it? So Saul sets out to kill him. And God gives him a word through Samuel, says, utterly destroy all. Don't spare any of them. So she's talking about nine things in her house. How many times do we look at stuff and we tolerate sin that's in here? We tolerate conditions that we know the Bible's totally against it. But we just give a little bit of compromise because it really ain't that bad until you stand in front of the throne room of heaven. Then you see it for what it really is and you go, oh my God, I'm in deep trouble. I mean, there's some sins in Galatians that do not inherit the kingdom of heaven. You see what I'm saying? Hello. So Saul comes back from the battle. Samuel shows up. He says, we done all that God asked. What? We did it all. We accomplished. I mean, I bet you he was just like a kid. Man, we did it. I mean, we're victorious. We went in and conquered. I mean, you still got the king, still got a bunch of sheep, bunch of calves. He says, what is this bleeding of the sheep and the calves I hear out there? Oh, well, the people wanted to bring some back to sacrifice to God. He said, what is sacrifice compared to obedience? Obedience is a whole lot better than your sacrifice. God asked you to kill them all. And so I wonder when we get to the end of the age and God asked us to subdue all our enemies and we kept a few chosen things back in our hearts. So you see, Saul's condition was different than David's. David, the prophet Nathan comes and tells him this man had one sheep. This other guy had a bunch of sheep and tells him the story. And David said, bring me the man. I'll kill him. And Nathan said, you are that man. And David falls on his face and said, oh, my God, I'm the guilty party. I'm wrong. God accepted David's repentance but refused Saul's. Because Saul's concerned about what people think. David was concerned about what God Almighty thinks. He could care less if he lost the whole kingdom as long as he's right with God. Those are the ones that God's about to pour his spirit out. We're about to have visitations from heaven. Glory's about to be poured out in the earth. And God's trying to get some canteens that are holy and acceptable before him. It's no different than our prayer life. Sometimes our prayers are not acceptable before the Lord. If your marriage is out of kilter, your prayers get stopped until that gets in union. Tell me there's not some seriousness and weightiness in heaven. So I'm looking at life, you know. One of the sins that will not inherit the kingdom of heaven is adultery, fornication. So I was watching this guy on YouTube today, and he's a black guy from overseas, and he's leaves his home that his daddy gave him. You know, his whole tribe went through where they just killed people. They lined bones up all down the streets, skulls and bones and mass murder and everything. So he leaves his daddy's house, leaves his job, and goes into full-time ministry. And he's seeking God, and he goes to this place, and there's about 40 people, and the church is really growing tight. He loves all the people. He's like, man, he's a pastor. He's, you know, full-time ministry, really going after it. And the Lord comes to him in a dream. Two dreams, then three dreams, and says, I want you to go back to your family, go back to your homeland. And he says, man, you got to be kidding me. That can't be from God. I mean, I'm grouped with all these people. I'm in tight with all these people. And another guy comes to their tribe and says, hey, talks to his pastor and says, hey, I got a word. I'm supposed to take his place. And he says, you're right. I've had three dreams that God tells me to go back. So long story short, he goes back. They take a church that had 300 people. They had 300 in one year, went all the way down to a pastor, wife, and one kid, one person. And so he started seeking the Lord about what's wrong with this thing. Because, I mean, I can go out and win souls, but if we had 300 people and now there's nobody, something's wrong in the spirit realm. Have you ever thought about that? When you look at your life, maybe the spirit realm's messed up and you got to get things right with God. And God has you in a holding pattern because he's trying to get you in alignment. His judgment standing before you because he's so concerned about you getting alignment and not missing heaven. What if he has everything on hold because he's trying to get you to make sure you're just right on target with what God wants? Then he'll cause you to just launch you out because he's here to prosper us. Everything in scripture is his mercies are new every morning. You know, his grace is sufficient for us. You know, no good thing will he withhold. I mean, over and over and over, if you trust him, then you'll walk in these blessings. You know, over and over and over, he wants to shower it, but he's trying to get us to get in right union with heaven. So this guy, he deals with that thing in the spirit realm. The church just blossoms all up. Then he goes and plants another church. Then he goes and plants another church. Signs and wonders start breaking out. Miracles are happening everywhere. Then he started getting words in his leadership. The words in the leadership was that you're in sin. So he gets his whole staff, and like Tom did with us, sat down last night, gives the four things, gets all the staff to sit down. He starts asking them. And so they had 12 of them on staff. Somebody's in sin. He examined himself. He didn't think it was him. Then they get another dream and another dream and another dream. He says, God, what's the deal? Where are we missing you? I mean, we're going out ministering, signs and wonders, anointing's happening. Then finally this lady says she was going somewhere. She had an open vision. The angel of the Lord comes and hands her an envelope with scriptures and gives it to her to give to him. And he gets it. Well, I'm not going to drag it on out. He later has an encounter with God. And God shows him it's him. And then starts showing him all the hidden sins he has in his heart. And the things that he's put up with and allowed to come into his life. And then not only that, he says when God showed him that, he still didn't have an entrance to pray. It's like heaven shut up and he wouldn't let him pray. Wouldn't let him commune. Because God was like, no, you're mature enough, but now I'm requiring more at your hands. See, some of us have gotten to a place of plateau that God's saying, no, before you can go any further with me, you got to surrender some more. See, what God does is when you first get saved, he gives you, I mean, you got, by grace you're saved, not through works, least any man should boast. So you come into the kingdom. I remember when I first got saved, I was so in love with Jesus. I mean, I spent 4 or 5 hours a day praying. I went out streets 2 and 3 o'clock in the morning, witnessing and sharing the gospel. And I remember a friend of mine, he locked bumpers and pushed my truck through a red light. So the next red light, I locked bumpers and pushed his little Toyota through. We get to the restaurant. He said, man, I felt so guilty. I said, what are you talking about? Man, I had to repent. Repent from what? Man, I pushed you through. I mean, we went through the red light. I said, oh, my God. I hadn't repented in 2 years. He said, do what? I said, no. I mean, I hadn't even thought about it. I just been like on a honeymoon with Jesus. I love him. I pray to him all the time. I mean, you know, I had 6 major sins when I got saved, and I dealt with them. And then we started working on my character. But I didn't realize, man, you know, this thing's serious. I better get some kind of adjustment. So our mindsets, a lot of times we build things and it's just flat false. Does this make sense to anybody? So anyways, I started going back saying, Lord, search me and try me. Even David said, search me and try me. See if there's any way in me. Teach me. This guy said, you know, God, I'm not seeing it. And so God starts giving me scriptures out of Romans 1 and Romans 2. And I'm thinking, good gosh. And when he was quoting it, you know, saying it, I was examining myself. And so he's right in the middle of it. And God says, fornication. And he says, oh, that's not me. And the voice stops talking to him instantaneous. And then waited a minute. He says, you calling me a liar? That's what the Spirit of God said. I never lie. You calling me a liar? And then instantaneous took him when he was in a mall, when he's this and that. And he had, how he had allowed vain imaginations to go through his head. He said, there's a difference in what you outwardly do versus what you really are inside. And what's inside of us is what we're trying to cultivate to bring the presence of God. But how many times do we get jealous over cultivating this ground and we don't give place to the devil? And we take out the sword of the Lord and we say, no, we're going to start cutting this sucker off. I allowed this little thing come in and I shouldn't have let it done. I should shut the thing down. You know what I'm saying? I mean, gross sins. I mean, it's like if we were standing in a grocery store and somebody just goes in and puts something in their pocket and they're going to walk out. You say, what are you doing, man? But yet the devil comes, the thief comes to steal and kill and destroy, and he'll come in just a little leaven. And before long, you're done rolling snowball down the hill and don't realize what happened to you, you know? I mean, we do. I mean, my wife has a whole lot better conviction on TV than I do. But back when I first got saved, I had a tremendous amount of conviction. I remember watching Raiders of the Lost Ark. Sitting in Maggio's and saw a demon come out of the TV screen, come across the thing, and I went outside and broke down crying like a baby. And my father-in-law and all of them came out, what's wrong? I said, nothing. I couldn't shake it. I was crying so bad. I remember watching Lord of the Rings 15 years later, and demons come out of the screen. It took me 15, 20 minutes to clean the house out. But there's a big gulf between that guy and that guy. And so it seems to me like the more and more more mature we get, the more we say, oh, no, we can handle that. Really? So he says in the last days, the thing that's going to cripple the church the most is, what did I tell you it was? Immorality, fornication, adultery. He said that's the biggest thing the devil's on because it's the thing that you do within your body. He said what happened to him is he was probably the most anointed in his ministry, did more signs and wonders and miracles than anybody on their staff, but he got all the accolades from everybody else and nobody knew what was going on in the inside. And it took him seeking God over and over and over. And then what they did is they took, a couple of them took a jug of water and all of them went up into the bush, into the mountains and stayed there until God came. They stayed the first 24 hours. God didn't show up. The second 24 hours, God didn't show up. They're on 48 hours. He said he went to lay his Bible down to just lay his head to sleep for an hour. And when he went and closed his eyes, he heard groanings and moanings crying out for God from some of his other staff. He said, how dare I go to sleep when we hadn't dealt with this issue? And he stayed a whole nother day before God showed up. And when God showed up, he started showing him all the secret sins in his life. Then he started showing him every secret sin in everybody else's life that was on staff. And there's 12 of them. He comes down from the hill, the rest of the people do, and he sits down and he says, this is what God showed me is in my life. This is what he showed me. He had just wrote down notes. Scott, this is what's in your life. Jane, this is what's in your life. Cammie, this is what's in your life. Krista, this is yours. He said the power of God hit them. They all started weeping and groaning and crying out to God to get their house in order. Now, what was significant about it is they were going for another village, another whole area. And everywhere they went to preach the gospel, people would mock them, ridicule them, say curses about God and about the Holy Ghost. And when you read the text, the very things that was in Romans is the very actions they were doing it. And he was responsible because it was in his life. He allowed that to be cultivated in his hidden lifestyle. Until he could deal with his hidden lifestyle, he couldn't demand it to come forth out of them. Is that not powerful? I thought that was profound. Anyways, it dealt with me. And I will get his name if y'all want to go through and look at some of his YouTubes. I don't know a lot about the guy, but for some reason I just went there today. He's, Mike Bickle. I never watched Mike Bickle's stuff, and it's probably to my hurt, not my gain. But for some reason, Mike Bickle was introducing him up there at IHOP, and he shared. So I think it's a good day for us to examine ourselves and see where we're at. Some of us got our ears closed right now in this season is because of our condition. We got judgments we've made, and we need to just say, Lord, forgive me for judgments that I had no business making judgments. I remember Bobby Connors one time said, God, how come I'm not having gold teeth and gold in my ministry? He said, because you judged it, and you said it wasn't me. And so as soon as he repented, that next meeting, gold started manifesting in the meetings. People got gold teeth, porcelain teeth, all kind of stuff. But he made a judgment. And sometimes we can make a judgment just within here without even voicing it out. Does that make sense? Anyway.
Okay, so we're going to do something real quick. Just kind of as a response to what we've been talking about. Because it's kind of heavy. You know, it just feels heavy. But so I want to give you guys a good word before we leave. Not that that wasn't all good. It was all great. It was all great, right? But here's something good for to wrap all this thing up and package it. Because, listen, God wants you to succeed, right? He's the one that put all this together, right? He's a God of multifaceted. He's diverse, right? And so but ultimately he's the one that's going to bring this to pass. Deuteronomy 30, I love this. It says this: if any of you are driven out to the furthest parts under heaven, from there the Lord your God will gather you, and from there he will bring you. Then the Lord your God will bring you to the land which your fathers possessed, and you shall possess it. He will prosper you and multiply you more than your fathers, and the Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your descendants to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, that you may live. Also, the Lord your God will put all these curses on your enemies, on those who hate you, who persecuted. Praise God. And you will again obey the voice of the Lord and do all his commandments, which I command you today. The Lord your God will make you abound in all the work of your hand, in the fruit of your body, in the increase of your livestock, and in the produce of your land for good. For the Lord will again rejoice over you for good as he rejoiced over your fathers. If you obey the voice of the Lord your God to keep his commandments and his statutes which are written in this book of the law, and if you turn to the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul,
Here's a good promise. For this commandment, which I command you today, is not too mysterious for you, nor is it far off. It is not in heaven that you should say, who will ascend into heaven for us and bring it to us? That we may hear it and do it. Nor is it beyond the sea that you should say, who will go over the sea for us and bring it to us, that we may hear it and do it. But the word is very near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that you may do it. See, I've set before you today life and good, death and evil, and the command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways and to keep his commandments, his statutes, his judgments, that you may live and multiply. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land which you go to possess. That's a good promise, right? It's like, hey, it's not too far. You know, it seems really far. It seems really hard. It's not. It's really not. It came down. Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. I am yours, right? Like, God came down to us, made this possible, and he resurrected and he gave us his grace to do this. It's all him. It's not us, right? So it's not above us. It's here. It's now. It's Jesus. It's the whole purpose. It's why we're here. It's what we're about. And so if you just could play just a song, and here's what I want to do. I want to pass these around. We're going to take communion real quick. And as she's leading us in worship, listen, I just want this to be a time where we can just go before the Lord and, you know, partake of him, you know, and proclaim. It says this often as we do this, we proclaim of his death. And when we proclaim of his death, we actually get the grace and the resurrection to walk these things out. And it's not by might, it's not by power, it's by his spirit, right? So, and yeah, if you would. And for some of you who are saying, well, you know, that sounded a little kind of, you know, well, listen, God is not a God that wants you to function in relationship based upon what he said. What he said is great, right? What he said is good. But really, God's a God of relationship. You know, he wants us to really know what he's saying. It's what he said. It's what he's saying. It's what he will say. And so right now, we're living in the now. We're living based upon what he's saying. And you remember when Jesus was led to the wilderness? Remember the devil started talking to him? Remember what he said? He said, hey, turn that stone into bread. He said, remember what he said? Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth forth out of the mouth of God. What's he talking about? There's a preceding word. There's a proceeding word, right? Proceeds. God has a proceeding word, and the proceeding word is speaking now, and this preceding word was speaking in the past, but he's speaking now, and ultimately we should know what the Lord is saying to us. And that's all we're saying is, hey, we need to be a people that know the voice of the Lord. And the Lord wants to speak to us, and he wants to speak to you, and he wants to speak into our situations. And so as we go before the Lord, and the Lord just, we appropriate the blood of Christ, and we appropriate the word of the Lord. We're saying, God, we need you. God, we got to have you, Lord. And so, Lord, these are your elements. We're your body. And we want to commune with heaven, Lord. We want to commune with a living God. And we want to proclaim of your death, your burial, and your resurrection. That in the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us, Lord. Lord, you said to your disciples, unless you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, you can have no part in me. And some said, Lord, this is a hard thing. I don't understand it. But Lord, you went to the disciples and said, are you going to leave too? And Lord, they said, no, we're not going to leave, God, because we don't understand what you're saying, but we know that you have the words of life. And God, that anywhere that the Spirit of God is just convicting us tonight, Lord, that we would just bring that before you and know that it says in your word that you were tempted in every way that we have been tempted. And God, you did not sin, and that you said when we're tempted beyond measure that you will provide a way of escape. So you're with us in the temptation. You understand our temptation. You understand our flesh because you were God in the flesh. You were the Son of Man. And so we follow your life. We follow the very spirit of power coming upon you to, Lord, the Lord helped you be obedient. And God, you will help us by the grace of God. You will help us enter into obedience and rest and enter into holiness and sanctification and righteousness. So we partake, Lord, first of of the bread. We take it of this of your body. Lord, we remember the word of the Lord. We examine ourselves right now. And we say, God, where is anything out of line, Lord, that we ask you would reveal that to us? Lord, if we have anything against our brother, Lord, I pray that you would bring clarity to that, and you would cause conviction to fall and to restore that relationship, to restore that whatever needs to be restored there, that there would be no sickness coming upon the body because we're taking communion in judgment, but that your word would propel us, Lord, and would be healing to us and cover us of all of our sins, our transgressions, and our iniquities. And God, we drink of the cup. We drink of your blood. And we say, God, that your blood is enough. Your blood is sufficient. Your blood has paid the price. Your blood speaks a better word, Lord. We love you, Jesus. So God, we give you permission to come. We yield to you tonight. God, make us holy vessels. Make us partakers of your divine nature. God, we want to be better leaders. We want to be better husbands, better wives, better friends. We're going to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, Lord. And when we do that, we'll love our neighbor. We'll exude the fruit of the Spirit. We'll walk in holiness, God. We won't be satisfied for anything but you. Our heart cries out for the living God. As a deer pants for the waters, God, so our soul just longs for you, Lord. And so we drink of your righteousness. We thirst for righteousness. You said those who hunger and thirst for righteousness shall be filled. God, we want our valleys filled tonight. We want our high places brought down. We want our crooked places straight. And God, we want our rough places made smooth. And we submit to the process. We submit to the Lordship of Jesus Christ.